Lost and down, down into the night now. And I Yeah. inside my thoughts, and when I start to think all the time, how close it starts to end up on the brink. I tried so hard, but all these scars, they cut so deep, I bleed. I fell so fast from heaven, it's like someone clipped my wings. Now I'm falling, and I can't see the ground. Can we stop this gravity? It keeps bringing me down.
I know I can make you believe something. watching the ocean with you. Baby, up with a slow motion crew. And we up in our growlings when people change, but not us. And we just chilling, kicking it, kissed by the sun. Could be soaked to the skin in the moss soon. I know she got the good vibes when seasons change, but we're the same. Even if I lost all my money, the zero runs deep, honey. And I don't need to speak a single word.
again. Trying hard, but you wanna be my friend. Ain't no place to hide, ain't no one to run to. Here we go again. Call my bluff, I'ma be here till the end. I'm the one you ride, I'm the one you ride to. If you don't wanna change, ain't no place to hide, ain't no one to run to. If you don't wanna change, I can help. Okay, everyone, good evening. I hope that we have everyone online who's going to be participating with us today. And I'm hoping that you have a wonderful time tonight. So we're ready for another patient health workshop, and it's good to be here. I might be a little bit tired, but you know, I'll do the best I can to stay as, you know, upbeat and up-tempo as possible. So I need your help to achieving that. I hope that everyone can hear me. If you can hear me, just kind of indicate in the chat so that I know that you are hearing me just fine. So let's just wait for some confirmation that everyone is hearing me okay, so that we can just get started. Sounds good, Geisha. Thank you very much for that. Beautiful Tamara. So tonight we're going to be talking about the topic that we have, which is how to achieve and maintain good health, which is the idea behind what we're going to be discussing. The topic itself is 7 keys to getting and staying well. So that's what we're going to be dealing with. So I'm excited. I'm hoping that you are as well. Thank you very much, Charlie. And who is Arbar? There's a question. And who is this Arbar? So I can answer you specifically. Who are you? And you're going off topic a little bit. We're going to be talking about something to do with the office, but I'll just take the time to quickly answer you. It is our intention that you get started as soon as possible. And if it is that we have the availability on the time slot, or you're able to wait around to get an available time slot, then certainly you can get started right away on your second visit. There is the only thing that prevents us from starting on the second visit is if you are given a report of findings at the end of the day, in which case there is no possible appointment thereafter, or after your report of findings, there is no available slots at the particular time that your report of findings is scheduled. But otherwise, we are able to start your treatments immediately after doing the report of findings, provided that time or the schedule would allow. So that's the only restriction. So let us begin, shall we? And please make sure that your name is indicated so that we can get the register going. I know who participated in the class, and we can get everything situated that way. So the topic again is 7 keys to getting and staying well. And of course, I'm Dr. Neil Gardner, and this is our contact information, and feel free to reach out to us if you have any questions. I'm going to ask, if you have not already done so, that you go ahead and subscribe to our channel. So that we can have you all being members of our family. Now, I'm going to point out something very important here. Hi, Heather. Welcome. Buenos dias or buenas noches to you, Atu. Now, we are, as far as the something that we have in the pipelines, I've been seriously considering doing a kind of a communication session with all of our patients. The problem that we have right now is that there's a lot going on with healthcare and with health in general, and with the whole issue of the pandemic and vaccinations and so on. I know a lot of people have questions. A lot of people are concerned, but the unfortunate thing is that information is coming from only one source. And because it's coming from only one source, people don't really feel like they have an option. And as such, a lot of people are bewildered. Well, I come from a very different standpoint. And my hope is that... let me see if I can get this camera to... get started. Okay, good. I think that's better. Get cleaned up a little bit. Yes. So I'm thinking about having this kind of a session where we can just get together and discuss these things. And if this is something that you're interested in, please let me know. All right, because I know people have questions. It might be a Zoom format, I'm not sure. But separate and apart from that, I want to be able to make sure we are a resource for people. At the end of the month, this month, April, well, next month, April, the 5th Thursday in April, we'll be having a special video presentation that I'm inviting all of you to participate. And I really hope that you do so, right? Because as it is, the plan that we have is to educate our people. And in educating our population, I've chosen to do different formats. The class is one, this presentation is one. But I also want to be able to do so via a movie time with me. So we will watch a documentary or something on health. It's very interesting, trust me. These documentaries are not documentaries where you say, boy, a boring thing you sit down through. No, these things are gripping, spellbinding, and, you know, what some will call controversial in some ways, because they're opening the eyes of the public to things that they otherwise would not get from mainstream media and help them to understand a few very important things. And I'm thinking about doing one on vaccination. Because there's so much that people don't know about vaccines, and they think that vaccines are safe, generally speaking, not just the COVID, but they think that vaccines are safe. They think that vaccines are very beneficial, and they think that it has really improve the situation as it relates to healthcare in the world, which is a position that is being said, but that is probably that couldn't be further from the truth. So it is my hope that, you know, you will be interested in tuning in. All right, so let me fix this camera here a little bit. I'm going to play a little music in the time being, and it should take probably less than a minute to do. I'm going to flip the camera around and use the light from my camera so that the image is better. So just hang tight for me. Okay. All right. Just trying to fix this camera thing here. Just bear with me a second. Just bear with me, everyone. I'm trying to get this thing nice for you since we're going to be spending the time. See what we got here. right, I think this is it. I think this is it. Drum roll, please. Ta-da! I think we look a little bit better now. All right, so remember to subscribe, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. So let us begin, because we've, you know, time has run away from us a little bit. So, you know, I don't want to have us not be able to get what we need to get done. So we're going to be discussing some things that hopefully will really benefit each of us tonight, because it is, like I said, it is my desire to be able to bring information that is really useful for persons, right? So let us begin from the top. So as we look through the different keys, there are 7 keys to getting and staying well. And the first one we're going to be discussing tonight is sick care versus health care. And it's important for persons to understand, when we talk about sick care and health care, what do we mean and what can we get out of it? One of the things that I think is important for us to, first of all, get sorted out in our minds is that the healthcare system is a good, it's a system that has good, it also has bad, it has limitations. But my goal is not to bash the system, but just to highlight some of the limitations of it so that people can make wiser choices for themselves and for their families. So when we talk about the current healthcare system, I hope people understand that the system is focused primarily on people who are sick. Right? It's focused on those who are sick among us. And because of that, the system is reactionary, meaning that we wait until something has gone wrong before we can act. And that's a limitation of the system. It doesn't really work well as a prevention strategy. It's very poor at preventing people from developing a disease or an illness. But it's very good at saving lives and easing suffering. In fact, those are the things that one would say are the focal points of this system. How to save lives and how to ease suffering. Now, when you look at the choices that are made, let's say somebody has cancer. Why would you give somebody that is already suffering or dying with cancer a drug or a treatment that is very toxic to the body? A treatment that is, for all intents and purposes, poison for the body. Why would you give the body poison as your intervention? The answer is, if you believe that by giving the body the poison, it will destroy the disease before the disease destroys the body, then you'll understand the mindset that goes into, cancer treatments. Our mindset is very different as non-medicinal providers. Our mindset is that the body is a self-healing, self-regulating organism. And so if it is that the body has developed cancer, the first question you have to ask yourself is, what limitation or what is deficient in the body that should be there that enabled the cancer to develop? Or two, what toxicity or what is in the body that is toxic to the body that the body should not be there so as to prevent the cancer from developing in the first place? So diseases, all illnesses start from two places. They start from either having not enough of something that you need or having too much of something that's not supposed to be in your system. Either way, you will develop disease. And so we have to try to look at ways of solving that problem. So the system that we have is a reactionary system. If you want to have a chance, any chance at all of being healthy, we have to change our approach to not just having a reactive mindset, but a proactive mindset, which means we have to do things to prevent illnesses from developing in the first place. And a lot of people, we may say that, well, what about blood tests? You know, you do your executive profile, it will tell you before something has gone wrong if something is going to go wrong so you can act. And the answer is no, it does not tell you that. What it tells you, the executive profile will let you know if your body has developed some imbalance that has shown itself up in the bloodstream or in the urine that signifies that a disease process is underway. In doing that, we can end up with what is known as early detection or early diagnosis. If you can detect something early, it is definitely better than waiting until it's later, because usually we can do something about it before the disease has really taken hold and has gone a far away. So you have to understand that blood work is important assessment, and I would say necessary assessment, but it doesn't prevent disease. It gives us early indication of a disease in progress. So if you want to have true healthcare, you have to be proactive, which means you have to have a preventative mindset. Do the things that you know are necessary to prevent disease from developing in the first place. And as I indicated, diseases come from either toxicities or deficiencies. And so you need to make sure that you don't have any deficiencies as much as possible, and you don't have any toxicities as much as possible. If you can remove those things from your life, then you have a better chance of obtaining good health. Now, we are in a crisis right now when it comes to healthcare. More people are sicker, but we are sick because of lifestyle diseases. It is lifestyle diseases that's causing us to get sick and to not be able to do the necessary things to maintain good health. And this is something that we do not want. We want to make sure that we are doing the very things that are necessary to promote good health. Now, drugs and surgery cannot be the answer to a lifestyle disease. Drugs and surgery cannot be the answer to a lifestyle disease. And we are spending more money on drugs and surgeries, how to come up with better surgical interventions, how to come up with the next wonder drug, rather than spending our time figuring out how to prevent people from needing the drugs in the first place. See, the medical system is an important system, but it's a business just like every other business, and it has consumers just like every other business, or customers just like every other business. The unfortunate thing is that the customer of the healthcare system is a sick person. And if the healthcare system is in the business of making sick persons obsolete, meaning that getting rid of the sickness or illness, then what will end up happening is the healthcare system will virtually be eliminating itself, because no business can survive without its customers. But the challenge that I have is when I see things happening that will produce more sick people than we need to be having. I think we have far too many already, so we don't need to be adding any more to the mix. But unfortunately, we're having more and more sick people being added to the whole mix of the whole illness paradigm. So let's move again, because I want people to realize that it's not easy to change the way you behave. But if you want to have a chance of improving or changing the way you're thinking about health or you're behaving toward health, then you have to change the way you think about health. So your mindset is what drives your behavior. I know a lot of people, they want to lose weight. I don't know if you fall into this category. You want to lose weight, and you find that you might go on a special diet, and for the first month or two, you know, you're struggling through the diet, and then after that, you can't manage anymore, you give up. Or you see the weight coming off too slowly for your satisfaction, and so you give up. if you look at the destination as your goal, you're in for frustration, because that's not what health is about. And so we're going to talk about the different ways of thinking, and hopefully this will help to clarify this for you. So there are two things: illness care and wellness care. The illness model, or the illness way of thinking, is taught to us by, I would say, mainstream media, by way of the ads that we see on TV or the things that we hear some of our medical providers, not all, some of them might be telling us. And that is, if you have something wrong, if you have pain somewhere, or if you have a headache, or if you have some ailment, we need to find the right pill or the right medication to take so that you can feel better. So the goal is simply feeling better. You know, if somebody has pain and you give them a drug and they no longer feel the pain, then the doctor will oftentimes say, well, that drug has worked for you. But really, has it worked for you? Has it? If your goal is simply just to feel better, then it has worked. But if instead your goal is to get better, then you know that it has not worked, because there is no medication that's going to get you better in and of itself. It's the body that gets better. And so we have to find ways of promoting that self-healing property that the body has. So ask a different question. Rather than what do I need to take to feel better, you will ask, what do I need to do in order to get better? And that will shift you from an illness mindset to a wellness mindset. Another way that the illness mindset guides us in thinking is, as I indicated earlier, is the destination as our goal. They want us to ask, what can I do to get well? Or people often ask that question, what can I take to get well? Or what can I do to get well? You know, as if wellness is a destination, as if wellness is an endpoint to arrive at. And once you've gotten there, you are there. And the reality is, no. You are not there once you've arrived. Because if you get to wellness and you stop doing the things that got you there, you will cease to remain there. So the goal about wellness is the journey, not the destination. And so we have to ask a different question. We have to ask, what do I need to do in order to stay well? In order to stay well. Because staying well is way more valuable than just simply getting well. So it's a destination that people focus on that ends up leading to frustration. I would suggest, if you focus on the journey instead and ask, what do I need to do ongoingly to maintain a healthy lifestyle, a wellness lifestyle? Then, if that is your question, I think you have a better chance of achieving success. Staying alive is a way that some people look at things as well, saying that, you know what, the longer we live is the better we are doing as a people. But I would suggest to everyone tonight that how long we live is not the true measure of a wellness system or a health system that is working. It is the quality of our lives that determine how well this system is working. If the majority of people who are 70 years and over have a very active and healthy lifestyle, then we can say the system is doing well, whatever it is. And when we say the system, I mean all branches of healthcare, not just medicinal, but non-medicinal as well. We're doing well for our society. But if we have a bunch of old people, but all these old people have to be in a nursing home because they can't care for themselves, or in hospice care, then is this system really doing well? For me personally, I know I want to achieve a good old age with vibrancy, not with suffering, as some people would say here in Jamaica, but feeling well. So rather than simply saying I want to stay alive, live as long as possible, how about what do I need to do in order to feel alive? Because feeling alive is way more valuable to me, certainly, than simply being alive. In fact, the moment I cease feeling alive, I start losing interest in being alive. The moment I stop feeling alive, I start losing interest in being alive. So, trying to promise me 2 more years of life if I have cancer is not something that's remotely attractive to me. If my quality of life is not also good. At some point, my family will mourn me. At some point, my friends will mourn me. At some point, I will die. And they will have to mourn me. My wife will have to mourn me if she's still around. So, what's the difference if I die today versus next week? What, I get to spend 1 more week with my family, 1 more month with my family? I'm still going to die and they're still going to have to mourn me. They might as well start mourning me now so that they can get over it a month earlier. Provided that it would take the same time, that is. But that's just my mindset. I know it's kind of grim and morbid, but that's kind of how I look at things. So look at the two columns here and you will see something that's very interesting. In the illness model, we have feel better, get well, and stay alive is the way that we think about healthcare or our health. But the way I would suggest that we think is get better, stay well, and feel alive. It's a very subtle shift from feel, get, stay, to get, stay, and feel. Now, and I want those of you who are online to kind of participate with this one here and answer this question. Is pain a good thing or a bad thing? Is pain a good thing or a bad thing? Please comment below, if below is where your chat area is, or comment off to the side, if that's where it is. But is pain a good thing or a bad thing? I want to hear your answers. I want to hear your answers. So start chiming in with your answers. If it is not a good thing, say so. If it is, and I don't want to on the fences. Some people are on the fences. So we would prefer that if you're not on the fence, you actually commit to a position. Not because you're right or wrong, because the goal of this is not to make sure that people are right or wrong. The goal is so that we can all learn together. And if you commit, you learn a little bit better. So, is pain a good thing or a bad thing? Faith says pain is a good thing. Anyone else? Tamara says, it's a good thing, sad to say. See if there's one more that might come in. All right, well, irrespective of what people think, right? Pain is not a good thing or a bad thing per se, but pain has a purpose. It has a function. There's a role to play that pain has to play. And what is the purpose of pain? Can you all read it with me? Pain alerts us that something has changed and requires attention. Something has changed. Something is different. Something has gone awry. Something is wrong. And since something is wrong, it tells us that we need to pay attention and try to intervene. The problem is that many people use pain as the primary yardstick by which to measure how well they're doing. But there's a problem with pain, and that pain is not able to tell us reliably when we're doing well and when we're not doing well, because it is possible to have pain and yet be healthy. And it is also possible to not have pain whatsoever and be completely disease riddled. So you can't trust pain to tell you when something is wrong, because good health is not the same as feeling good. So just because somebody feels good doesn't mean that they're healthy. And that's important to realize. Good health means that we have healthy function. Good health means that we have healthy function. And it's a healthy function that really drives us, right? So that is important to point out. How do we know if our function is healthy? We have to check the different systems and do things that are essential for to promote the health of that system. And that is key. So trust our function, not our feeling, is what we need to be doing. Trusting the way our bodies are working, not how our bodies are feeling. And yes, Dorrit, pain is a good thing. And without it, actually, we die a lot earlier. I can explain to you the mechanism by which that happens. But that's not so critical. So, very quickly, looking at the different systems of the body, because in order for us to know if our bodies are doing well, our systems must be doing well. So when we look at the systems of the body, there are several different systems. There is the immune system, the digestive system, cardiovascular, integumentary, respiratory, endocrine, reproductive, excretory, musculoskeletal, and the nervous system. These are the different systems of the body. And there are things that are essential to maintain the health of all our systems. And the main thing that we can do to promote or maintain the health of our bodies or the health of our systems is what we put into our bodies. It's the kind of foods that we eat, the kinds of things that we drink. I know a lot of people, I see a lot of persons still drinking soft drinks. I mean, isn't there enough information out there to let you know that soft drinks are very bad for you? And then you go on and you develop diabetes or some other disease, chronic disease, and then you are wondering, poor me, how this happened to me? Almost without exception, but there are always exceptions. Whenever we end up with a disease in our bodies, I want you to get this straight, all right? The earlier we can understand this, is the faster we get better, or the quicker we can regain control over our health. If it is that you develop a disease in your bodies, it is entirely or partially your fault. It's our fault. We are responsible for what goes into our bodies. Whether we eat it, we drink it, we inject it, we put it on our skins, we put it in our hair, whatever it is, we are responsible for everything that enters our bodies. I'm not responsible for what enters your body. You are responsible for what enters your body. If you are given poor information, and because of this poor information, you decide to act, and you act incorrectly, you cannot blame the information. You have to blame yourself. It's unfortunate, but it's the reality. I know that there are many people who are pushing this vaccine thing. But just understand that whatever the outcome is, it is your doing. It is your responsibility. If you allow them to inject something into your body that you don't understand, or something into your body that could potentially be poisonous or toxic in any way, something in your body that you see affecting other people, and you're going to say to yourself that, well, the majority of the people don't have it, so I'm expecting that I'm in the majority, so I will go ahead and take it. Then whatever the outcome is, live with it or die with it. It is your own doing. I am not here to tell anyone what to do. I know what I intend to do, but I'm not here to tell anyone what to do, but to help to provide information for persons. So I will stay online for about 5 or 10 minutes after the lecture. If you have any questions you want to ask me for my opinion on anything, and hopefully it will be of benefit to you. And I'll try to be as candid as possible, and hopefully don't get deplatformed from this source, because censorship is very real. Because they don't want the population to get any contrary information, lest they don't follow the protocols. So, let us move forward again, shall we? Of all the systems of the body, the nervous system is considered to be the master control system, which means that it is the system that governs and regulates all the other systems of the body. That's the nervous system. And so, when we look at the nervous system, we have to realize or recognize that this system has a couple very important elements to it. One such important element happens to be the organs of this system. What are the organs of this system? The organs of the system are the brain and spinal cord, and then the nerves that come off. Those are the players that we're dealing with, right? And I want to point out something here, because this chart that I show you here, this diagram, happens to be what is known as the autonomic nervous system chart. It's a system that shows all the connections for the automatic functions of the body from the brain and spinal cord. And I want you to recognize something here. If you look very closely, you will see two things. One is you will see that from the spinal cord or from the brainstem, these different organs all have a connection. One connection is yellow, if you see the yellow, and the other one is blue. And they're not colored this way in our bodies, but it's colored this way to show you that there are two separate things that connect to each of our organs or each of our blood vessels or what have you, each of our glands. The blue ones, or the ones that are highlighted or colored blue in this diagram, they represent what is known as the parasympathetic nervous system. And the yellow ones represent the sympathetic nervous system. The sympathetic nervous system is your fight or flight reaction. So when you're stressed, that is the system that activates. And so anything that happens when you're stressed, you know that it's happening as a result of the turning on of that system. So watch carefully. For this system, the yellow ones are the stress ones, and if it goes to the heart, what happens to the heart? It speeds up the heart. What happens to the lungs and the airways? It causes the breathing to become deeper, faster, and more forceful. It causes increased blood vessels, or the not increased blood vessels, but a constriction of the blood vessels within the lungs to push blood deeper into the lungs for greater and faster oxygen exchange, because oxygen would be needed when you're in a stressful environment, like a tiger or a dog or something is attacking you and you have to get away. Your digestive system, on the other hand, works in a different way. Your digestive system works by way of, for that system, it slows it down. So the yellow bands here slows down the digestive system. So whenever we are stressed, our digestive system shuts down. So if somebody's attacking us, we don't feel like having a buffet or having a beautiful meal. No, if somebody's chasing us, we want to escape. We don't feel hungry. We have no desire for food. And we certainly have no appetite. And that's why sometimes when people are, you know, stressed at work, or they are, they have a deadline to meet and they're working around the clock, what have you, they may not even feel the need to eat. On the other hand, if you are chronically stressed, meaning stressed for a long time, you may end up not only having a desire to eat, but to eat junk food. Foods that have a lot of simple sugars, because simple sugar gets used for energy a lot quicker than complex sugars. And your body needs simple sugars when you are stressed. The problem is the net result of simple sugars is fat. And so if you continue to eat a lot of simple sugars, eventually, especially when you're stressed, you will store a lot of fat. So this is important. All right? This is important. So I hope this makes sense to you all. Please do remember to subscribe and click the notification icon so that whenever we are live, you will be notified, as we intend to go live at the end of April. All right, bear that in mind. Well, the last Thursday in April. So please mark that on your calendar, the last Thursday in April. All right, so let's move again. The nervous system is the master control system of the body, and vertebral subluxations, which is also called spinal misalignments, cause nervous system dysfunction. It is these spinal misalignments that cause a lot of problems for the nervous system itself. Now, yes, there are different diseases and so on that can happen that will affect the nervous system, but the majority cause of problems in the nervous system is as a result of some trauma that led to the vertebral system being out of its proper functional organization. So let me show you an example of what we mean by this. All right. If it turns out that you have, if you look at the spine, and you're looking at this spine in particular, right? You will see that the third bone from the top, 1, 2, 3, happens to be out of alignment with the others. Can you see that? The third bone is out of alignment from the others, this bone. Because of that misalignment, it has put it has caused a closing off of the nerve, the opening where the nerve exits, as well as the cartilage between the bones. They get pushed out of position. When your disc has shifted out of position, we call it a slip disc. So if you've ever wondered what a slip disc looks like, it's kind of like this, where the bone has shifted out of place, causing the disc to slip. Now, what's also important to note is the openings where the nerves exit. So when you see this opening here, the opening where the nerve exits is where start to get closed down as soon as the disc, the bone starts getting pushed out of place. So if the bone gets pushed out of place, the opening in the back will start to close off, and it may pinch on that nerve. If it pinches on the nerve, then you will start having issues with the compromise of the nerve. Depending on what a nerve controls or supplies will determine what symptoms you have. So bear that in mind, all right? Bear that in mind. Let's say, for argument's sake, you have a child and that child has climbed a tree. And they climbed the tree, they fell out of the tree. They fell out of the tree, and having fallen out of the tree, they land on their backs. And by landing on their backs, they now develop a shift in the in a couple of the bones in the spine in the upper part of the back, which causes compression of these nerves. If this particular nerve is the nerve that goes to your airway, then what will end up happening is it may cause the airway to over-respond as if you are stressed. And so it may cause your airways to either constrict or to open up and dilate. If your airway muscles constrict, which is what happens when you're stressed or what happens when you have asthma, then the symptoms of asthma is what you will see. Even if the person doesn't really have asthma, the symptoms of asthma will be manifested if you interfere with the nerves that control the muscles of the airways. And this is critical, right? This is critical. There are many things, however, that can cause asthma to develop. So don't believe for a moment that I'm saying that once a child has asthma, that realigning their spine is going to fix the asthma. What I am saying is that if the person has asthma, then it is possible that it's coming from a spinal problem. I would say it's probably most likely to be coming from a spinal problem. And if you fix that spinal problem, the asthma will go away. How do I know this? Well, some may argue that is because I learned it in school, which I did learn it in school, in chiropractic school. In fact, it's one of the reasons I decided to really get into chiropractic as much as I did is because of what I learned about its relationship to asthma, particularly. But the reason I say that, and I say that categorically and without the fear of anyone saying anything, is that I have done numerous treatments on many persons, both children and adults, who have asthma, that during the course of treatment, their asthma symptoms, and I say their symptoms, almost entirely go away. And because the medical system says once you have asthma, you always have asthma, as a principle, I'll just go with that and say that they no longer have any asthma-related symptoms. And I won't say they no longer have asthma, but they no longer have asthma-related symptoms. All right, I'll just put it that way. Right, and these are people that I see personally. The next thing is lifestyle stresses, which occur in three dimensions, are the causes of our bodies breaking down, whether it is by misaligning the bones or by introducing chemicals or toxins to our bodies that should not be there. For example, physical stress like a car accident or a fall, or somebody punched you in the head or something, or somebody took a stone and threw and hit you in your face, or something fell on your head. These things will cause misalignments of the spine, and so we have to do what we can to correct this. A stressor can be either physical, biochemical, or psychological. Now, a healthier nervous system, or the healthier the nervous system is the better we can adapt to stresses in our environment. The healthier our nervous system is, the better we can adapt to stresses in our environment. I'll kind of skip through this one, except to say that our ability to adapt is determined by the width of our gap, and our gap is our general adaptive potential. In other words, our ability to adapt to our environment, to stresses, is based on the health of this adaptive potential. The better we can adapt is the better health we have. And that's basically how it works. So chiropractic what chiropractic does, it gives us a healthier nervous system, right? It helps to promote a healthier nervous system. And the promotion of a healthier nervous system is not an end-all be-all, because chiropractic in and of itself won't be sufficient to give us a healthy nervous system. There are many other things that we have to do as well to ensure this. And so our nutrition is important, our rest is important, our supplementation, if we have to supplement is also important. So that's important, right? Now, chiropractic, because of its ability to improve our nervous system function, we say that chiropractic can widen our gap, which is our general adaptive potential, which is our ability to adapt to our environment. If you improve the nervous system function, you improve the function of the body in its environment. Our office has invested in technology to help us to identify subluxations wherever and whenever they happen in the body, to be able to know whether it's a chiropractic situation, yes or no. And I would say of every 100 people I treat, or 100 persons I treat, I would say probably less than 2 of them would have an issue that is not related to their spine. And that's how numerous or how pervasive spinal issues are. And the vast majority of those are things that we can help to address. And if we address it, what we do find is that these people do get better. Very important. Maxine, if you want to talk off the air, just give a call to the office and ask if I can give you a call back. Leave your number. Make sure we have your number, and I'll try to call you when I have the availability. All right? So we can do that. So our technologies that we employ here in the office, one is called the rolling thermal scan, which measures skin temperature up the spine. This is that. The other one is called a surface EMG, which is measuring muscle tension coming down the spine. And tomorrow, yes, you can have trauma as a child that affects you as an adult. In fact, I've seen numerous young adults in particular. Because when you have trauma as a child, you know, most of these things, trauma usually takes 5 to 10 years before symptoms will manifest, and about 10 to 15 years before you can see it on any imaging like an X-ray or an MRI, depending on how severe the problem is. I mean, obviously there are some things that you can have happen immediately and some things that will take a little bit longer. But yes, you can have things that happen as a child that enters into adulthood. And I've seen young adults, people in their 20s, with problems that they had from a child, and now in their 20s they have arthritis, osteoarthritis, which is what they call old people disease. So yes, we have to take it seriously, all right? All right, so this is an example of a study that was done, a case study, where they looked at a lady who was asked to wiggle her left ankle, and given a chiropractic adjustment, and before the chiropractic adjustment, to have her spine checked to see how much it's functioning. These on the left-hand side, and I'll try to see if we can get a little bit bigger here so we can all see. All right, so basically, you can see all the areas of lights within the brain, which are showing you areas of activity within the brain. On the right-hand side, you see a lot fewer lights. These lights actually correspond to what we would expect if the person is healthy and did that same task. So clearly there's an interference going on for that person, because there's too much activity happening here when it should be a lot less. Well, after the adjustment, it went from here on the left to what you see here on the right hand side. And this was immediately after. So it's not days after or weeks after, it's immediately after. And the beautiful thing about the nervous system is that it models itself or remodels itself or has the ability to remodel itself very quickly. And that's why we can have somebody get a chiropractic treatment and they get off the table and they are immediately better. Not everyone, but some do. All right? So that's something to point out. Now, as far as it relates to chiropractic care, we have to understand that a chiropractor is not a bone doctor, because what we do doesn't impact the bones nearly as much as it impacts the brain and its function. So we will say that a chiropractor is a nervous system doctor, not a bone doctor. So please don't go saying that I'm a bone doctor to anybody that you talk to. What we do impacts the nervous system. All right? I'm also a chiropractic neurologist, which a chiropractor is trained to realign the spine, but chiropractic neurologists have specialized training again to retrain the brain itself. So what we do is able to stimulate specific areas of the brain to try to improve their function. So that's something very important. These are some examples of conditions that we have treated successfully here in the office. By successfully, we don't mean that they all went away, but they all improved. And not every one of these cases have improved, because we've had people in most categories that didn't really show much of an improvement. But I've had persons in all of these categories that have improved. Now, at our office, we want to be able to do three things as our focus, right? Identify subluxations wherever and whenever they happen. Put people on a program of chiropractic care to improve nervous system function. And that usually takes 12 sessions for a phase of care. And sometimes people need multiple phases of care depending on how they're doing. But a phase is typically 12 sessions, and this helps us to move people from where they are to where they ought to be or where we would like to see them. The last one is to educate our community about chiropractic and how to live a healthy lifestyle. And this is one of the ways that we choose to educate our community using this tool on social media. Who's responsible for health? Our responsibility for getting and staying well is for us to take responsibility for health and well-being, and that responsibility rests on us. We are the ones responsible for health and well-being. And if it is that you are living with somebody who has authority over you, and they're the ones that make decisions of that nature for you, then they are responsible for your health. For example, you may have an ailing parent who you're caring for, and you have to be making medical decisions for them. Or you have a child that you obviously will be caring for, and you have to be making decisions on their behalf. But outside of that, we are each responsible for our own health and well-being. There are testimonials on our website. I'm inviting you to please pay attention to them, watch them. If you like them, comment on them and so on. But there are some good testimonials. I haven't put on any on there recently, because we have probably too many persons. I think we're kind of oversubscribed right now. And the waiting time is too long to see me. And we're trying to put measures in place to remedy that situation, because I can understand how frustrating that would be for our patients or people who are trying to come in to see us. It is my hope that we'll be able to get another doctor in the office and train them to do things a particular way, and then that person can assist with the patient care. The only thing is that Jamaicans kind of interesting is that they love, they want to work with the boss. Me work with the boss. You want with the plebs. Me work with the boss. But the goal is to make sure that the person, whoever it is that comes, is capable of doing a similar standard of care to what I would be doing, if not better. So we're trying to work on that for you. So please, as soon as we have that wrapped up, we will do what we can there. And Kimoya says that her brain needs some retraining. All right, so we can take a look at that possibility, Kimoya. Now, we have a very special offer. We have a very special offer for those of you who might be joining us, who are not currently patients of ours, that might be thinking about becoming a patient. If you're interested in being a patient, then or if you already made an appointment but haven't yet come in for your exam, then what I'm about to say applies to you. If it is that you are interested, I'm going to suggest that you send off an email tonight, or if not tonight, by tomorrow, to appointments@gcnjamaica.com. That's appointments@gcnjamaica.com. And I've included the email address in the chat, so feel free to reach out to that email and send your request for the appointment to be made, right? Because if you make the appointment tonight, not only will you get, or you will actually get, not only, but you will get a 40% discount off your new patient examination and neurospinal scan fees. So whatever the combined fee would be for the new patient exam and scan, you will automatically get a 40% discount off the new patient exam. If it is, so please make sure, and you have to indicate your name and contact information so that Karen can contact you back, all right? But for existing patients, which are anyone who has already come in for a new patient examination and have done their report of findings and we've accepted their case, they are an existing patient. If I don't accept your case, then clearly it doesn't apply, right? Because you're not going to benefit in this way. But if you are an existing patient, you've come in for your exam already, and we've already done your report of findings and we're now going through your treatments, you will be given a 20% discount off the update examination. You'll also get 20% discount off one treatment per person that you refer. So if you refer 10 people, you'll get 10 20% discounts, or one, well, you can get one 20% discount off every treatment for 10 treatments, or you can get two free treatments, because a 20% discount times 5 would give us one free treatment. And if you get 10 people, then that would be 10 times the 20% discount. So that would be of benefit to you, right? The last thing that you will get is a 10% discount of the entire next phase of care. And we've already discussed that. A phase of care is 10%, is 12 visits here at the office. So if you've already done a series of treatments, When you get to the update exam portion, we're going to do another phase of care. You'll get 10% off the entire phase of care. And that dollar value is actually more than the 40% discount of the new patient exams all by itself. So that's important for us to bear in mind. Now, the seven keys to getting and staying well is for us. The key, the primary key, the last key, the ultimate key is that we must take responsibility for our own health and well-being. And everything that goes into our bodies is our responsibility. Whether it is something that we eat or drink, it is our choice. No one can force you to put something into your body that you do not want to have into your body. It doesn't matter what they say or how uncomfortable they make the situation. Even if it is something that you want or you would otherwise want on another time, but you don't want it then, nobody can force you. It's the same thing that it is possible for a husband or a wife to rape the other. Because even though the sex act is free within the marriage confines, the consent between the two persons must always be maintained. It must be maintained. If you don't maintain it, you will destroy the relationship. So it's not a right or wrong issue. You will destroy the relationship in that regard. So how much more when it comes to our bodies, when it's not somebody that we're married to? When it's somebody who is a stranger who we do not know, who is trying to sell us a lotion or a potion, tell us that this pill will make you stronger. This pill will put on 20 pounds of lean muscle on your body. This drug is going to cure all of your diseases. This injection is going to prevent you from ever getting sick. All of these promises are promises made by people to get you to do things that they want you to do. Not to get you to do things that are in your best interest to do, to get you to do things that they want you to do. See, the way I look at it is, any decision that's motivated by fear ceases to be ethical. If you want an ethical decision to be made, you have to be, it has to be motivated by information. And that's why every medical procedure has to go with it informed consent. And one thing I know, and I see it happening, is that people are getting this injection now and they're not being informed about the risks associated with getting an experimental injection. Bearing in mind that any study that was done about efficacy can only speak to short-term efficacy. It cannot speak to long-term efficacy. So if they say they did a test, and this is what people don't understand, is that in these studies that were done, that you hear 90% efficacy, 95% efficacy, in all of these studies that were done, I'm going to change the view here because I want to really get closer to you here, right? I want to get closer to you here. In the studies that were done for this particular injectable, to determine efficacy, they only looked at the first 95 people who tested positive for COVID. This was for one of the companies, not both. I don't remember the exact number for the second one. But for one of the companies, it was the first 95 persons after the second dose. They tracked them and tested them. And after the persons who received the second dose in the study, when they had the 95th person to have tested positive for the virus, they stopped assessment and then they looked at the two groups to see how many people who tested positive came from the vaccinated group and how many people came from the unvaccinated group. What they found, which was interesting, is that it was four people from the vaccinated group that tested positive, and 91 people from the unvaccinated group that tested positive. So that's how they got their 94% or whatever the percentage was. It's close to 94%, right? There's a flawed way of how that is done, that doesn't apply to us. But if you don't understand how this system works, you latch on to the notion of 95% efficacy and think in your mind that it means that there's a 95% chance that you are protected if you get the injection versus the other person if they don't get the injection. That's the conclusion that people will draw naturally, but that's not what the test did. Because that conclusion requires you to expose the person who has been vaccinated to the virus and see whether they contracted it. That is called a challenge study. In other words, they're supposed to challenge the system to see if, having been vaccinated, does that vaccine offer protection when you're exposed to the virus. That is what should have happened and did not happen. None of the tests that were done to determine efficacy did that. Not one of them. None of them did that. So there was never a challenge study done for any of them. So they don't even know what will happen to the person if they are vaccinated and then are exposed to the virus. They don't know. I heard an alarming piece of information just today that someone who was a politician got the vaccine, tested positive for COVID, and died of COVID. Let me tell you something here. And this is the kind of thing that upsets me so much as a natural healthcare provider, because there is a lot of irresponsible behavior happening now and we need to stop it. Our medical providers need to provide protection and guidance for us that is balanced and fair. And how can they tell us that anything is safe that there's never been a safety study for? The safety tests have never been done. Please, my medical brothers and sisters, the safety studies have not been done for none of the vaccines. They only look at what happened in the short term to see of the group what are the immediate reactions. But the only type of reactions that typically are immediate for vaccines are allergic reactions. They are the primary immediate response. There are many other things that can happen that do not happen immediately, that may take months or years to develop. One of them is cancer. No cancer study has been done. So we do not know if these things could cause cancer. What's the point in taking it and develop some cancer down the road if you don't have to? There's nothing that has been done for fertility. And I can say categorically that it is totally unknown whether this injectable, this vaccine, will impact the fertility of men or women. And you may wonder, how do I know this? And that's because I read the study. This is what was a requirement in the study, when you read the methodology in the study. A requirement is that every participant in the study must be on birth control. Every participant. If you miss a dose of your birth control medication and you are in the study, they can eliminate you from the study. And they did eliminate persons from the study if they missed their birth control dose. They have to sign to that to maintain that birth control status throughout the entire study. If you're a male and you're in this study, your partner or anyone you had sex with has to be on birth control medication. Not simply enough to say that you use a condom, but your partner has to be on birth control medication so that no one will become pregnant during the study. Because if somebody became pregnant during the study, then they will be compelled by ethics to determine what happened to that baby who got pregnant, who was sired or conceived during the time of the study. If there is a genetic flaw or abnormality, they'd have to report it. If there is infertility, it would have to be reported. But you cannot determine infertility when everybody's on birth control. So right now, we do not know what will happen to the fertility status of anyone. And nobody. And my medical brothers and sisters, please. If the study was not done, do not contradict me to say that it is safe. Or it is okay for it will not cause infertility because the data is not available. So practice good ethics, good scientific ethics, and not go down that road, please. All right? Because I'll call you out on it. So there's so much that is happening now that is unknown, and it is unknown, and it's upsetting to me that our providers of healthcare, who are supposed to be the watchdogs for us, the our gatekeepers, the ones who have our backs, are telling us that this thing is safe and the safety studies have never been done. The only reason that this thing is approved is because of an emergency situation, and it's an emergency use authorization, both by the FDA and in Europe. I don't remember what their body is called. I think it's ENA or something like that, that their body is called. So please, you have responsibility for everything that gets into your body. If you decide to go ahead with the data that you have been presented already, and you're comfortable with that information, you decide that you want to go ahead, by all means, go ahead. I am not going to try to stop you, because I am not responsible for your health. You are responsible for your health. All right, so this is the situation that we have at hand. Gosh, I wish I had access to the link right now to the study. Let me see if I can find it here online. A lot of these things are actually removed from being online anymore and not so available, but I'm gonna check and see if I bookmarked it. Just bear with me here, because I love to give confirmation, right? I love to give confirmation. It's exosome viruses, codes, informed consent. There's okay, I'm gonna. All right. No. No, it's not in, I don't have it here. But I'm gonna share one that I do have, that I do see here in my bookmark. It's a good study. This one is on informed consent disclosure to vaccine trial subjects of the risk of COVID vaccines potentially worsening the disease itself. And this is the one I spoke to, right? That it is, the information is now out that if it is that you receive this vaccine, there is a possibility that you have a higher risk of severe disease if you are exposed to the virus afterwards. So I've just posted that one. Triona, I just posted that one. So you can do that. It's a PubMed article, and this was for the study, right? Read it, take your time and read it. I don't have the other ones readily available. The one from the company itself, that one I read from I got the PDF from a doctor colleague of mine who sent me the PDF on the vaccine from one of the companies. I don't want to call the name of that company. And in their own document that they sent out, it outlined the study that was done and the 25,000, however many people that were in that study, how long they tracked the people for before they determined efficacy, and the methodology in the study, which stipulated that all candidates had to be on birth control. So that is that one. I'll keep looking for it and see if I find it, because that one is so important. And if you're interested in reading the actual papers, I think it's better to read the actual papers, because you don't have to take somebody's opinion. You take the information from the sources themselves. I spoke a lot. We digressed. But, you know, I hope you learned a thing or two from the class tonight. I just share some of our information here, that if you want to get in touch with us or follow us or see our information, you can, our website is gcnjamaica.com, and from our website I think you can have access to both our Instagram page and our Twitter page. I think it's accessible on our website. Or you can follow us on Facebook, join us, become a friend on Facebook by going to GCN Jamaica, right? GCN Jamaica. Or you can go to YouTube and just type in Gardner Chiropractic and subscribe to our channel. So that way, whenever we are live, it will post. And remember, on the 5th Thursday in April, we're going to have a special show. That's the 29th of April. On the 29th of April, most likely it's going to be 6 o'clock, I'm going to show a video I'm almost sure I'm going to do it on vaccination, because I want you to kind of see, get a little bit more history about it, because a lot of persons don't know much about it. They just take what they hear on media. But media sometimes don't give us the whole story. And there's a radio program that we have that we have online every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Jamaica time for 1 hour. It's called Back to Health. And if you join us on Facebook, we stream it live on Facebook at Back to Health Talk Show. So with all that information, I hope that you would have learned something and that you would have benefited from what I shared. Remember, if you are interested in coming in for a new patient exam, click, I've sent in the email address for you to reply to let them know that you were in the class and you want to take advantage of the offer. It's a free offer just for being a part of the class. So the address is appointments@gcnjamaica.com. appointments@gcnjamaica.com. And you have to ensure that your name was reflected in the chat section. That's how we know you listen to the show or you listen to the lecture. Your name was in the chat so that we can know that you legitimately were here. All right. It was a pleasure being here with you tonight. If you have any questions, I'll be sure to answer them for you. So thank you for your time, and I'll just stick around for a couple more minutes and try to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you, KT Squad. For the comment on loving our Back to Health talk shows. I appreciate that, and we try to really do a lot of research to make sure that it is valuable and that you benefit all the, as much as possible. All right, so may God bless each and every one of you. Have a wonderful night. It's almost time for curfew, but it's good to be in the healthcare system, because they give us a little bit of a leeway on the roads if we are caught in a curfew being a doctor. And I believe that this is important information to share. And so we appreciate your being here with us. So have a wonderful night. Thanks for those who have been sending out your thank yous. I appreciate it. And I'm going to just leave you with some copyright-free music that you can now use to just kick back and enjoy yourselves while I enjoy a song or two while I try to answer whatever questions you may have. So have a wonderful night. May God bless and keep you.
To repeat.